Hey folks, Music the Lifeblood is not a politically correct content maker, so the following episode might have some colorful and or explicit commentary on the subject at hand. Listener and viewer discretion is advised.
This is a really great talk. Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have tuned yourself into another episode of Music the Lifeblood's Conversations from the Pit. I am your very humble host, Dustin. Join with me, as always, the big bubby to my little bubby, my older brother, Derek, Music the Lifeblood's own roving reporter. Derek, it's snowing.
Snowing. It's like a son of a bitch. And it's, fucking hate it.
It is. What is it we're talking about on this fine, crisp, frigid, white evening?
All things Megadeth.
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 I'm going to start the show off with a quote.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Sure.
and I quote, "Overall, Peace Sells is a boring album at best." End quote. My brother, Derek. So, there's another reason I won't be attending Christmas this year.
reason number two.
I threw the phone. I threw the phone when I read that because I was in that moment fucking furious at you.
I don't why.
I was ashamed. I was ashamed for you. That's whatever. I love that album, and I can't wrap my head around why you wouldn't. I can't do it.
I can't wrap my head around why you would fucking love that album.
Dude, it's amazing. It's amazing. It's my favorite Megadeth album. Now, That's my favorite one. That's the one I have the strongest attachment to. Now, I don't think it's the best Megadeth album, but it's my Megadeth album.
Okay, whatever. It's very political. I don't like that aspect of it.
Well, you and I differ on that front, obviously.
Yeah. I do not like the politics and musically I get bored about three or four songs in, and I'm like, I'm done. This is the same bullshit.
Oh, man, I can't wrap my head around it. I think, I'm pretty sure I've talked to you about it before. That weird sort of thing that happens when artists and musicians, band, whatever, it's all when they're deep in the throes of really gnarly substance abuse. It's almost like it lends them artistic credibility sometimes.
Oh, sure.
And I think I'm straight edge. I'm in my 40s now, and I've been straight edge since I was 12 when I found out about it. And the thing I keep thinking about is
like, I'm not supposed to like this album, you know? it's like, they're, you know, when you get two jazz musicians in your band, and they're all like, fucking heroin, you guys.
Yeah.
We got heroin, you guys.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of those things where, like, this doesn't make sense in my head, but oh my God, the ending of Devil's Island when the double bass kicks in. I think that's the closest I've been to heaven.
Fucking Christ. That's too much. It's good.
Why don't you like it? I don't get it. I just got bored
with the songs, I think. And the politics is too fucking much for me. I'm listening to some good metal. I don't fucking care what you think about the State of the Union.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
It was the Reagan 80s, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I think it was. But you like Metallica. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, James as a lyricist doesn't, you know, it's not politics constantly, but obviously he touches on that stuff.
He touches on it, but I feel like that album, it's politics front to back.
A little bit. Well, no, I mean, The Conjuring is about talking to that old devil.
Yeah, it is. It is, you know? But yeah.
And Devil's Island is, you know, about going to the Devil's Island.
I just don't like that album.
Is it just that Peace Sells, just kind of the stank of Peace Sells?
Yeah. It's the taint of Peace Sells on the whole album.
Man, I fucking love it.
That album's not my gig. I just don't like that album.
I don't know. Gar, their drummer at the time, Gar, is what I'm always really excited to listen to.
Yeah. I think.
And then Chris Pullen as a guitar player. You know, the leads are pretty evenly split in Megadeth between Dave and whoever the other guitar player is. And
yeah,
Chris Pullen, you know, good Lord, some of the stuff he plays on that album, it's because you know, everybody says jazz sounds awful. It sounds out of tune, and it's not out of tune. It's just that the key is moving constant. Yeah. And it's hard for, you know, just sort of the regular ear to adjust to it sometimes. And some of the leads Chris Pullen does where you go, that might be a flat, but it's not now, you know, mm-hmm. It changes so quickly that it, for me, it just makes it exciting to listen to it. But
yeah,
I cannot stand Killing Is My Business and Business Is Good. Like, I hate that album with a passion. I think it sounds half baked to me.
Well, I think there's a lot. I think a lot of Megadeth's catalog is, it gets squirrely every once in a while, completely.
Mm.
I think shit gets disjointed.
Yeah. There's no other way to say it. Megadeth has a bad habit of writing bad songs sometimes.
I think so. And I don't know if, it's because Dave's personality is kind of all over the place. I mean, you don't know which end of the spectrum he's on all the time. And I'm guessing that day to day with him and his writing and musically, it's probably the same way. It's just every once in a while, shit's really disjointed and doesn't seem like it belongs. And
I mean, he's got a reputation.
Well, for sure.
You know, is he? I always feel like when people talk about Dave Mustaine, it's almost like it's what I would imagine they say about me.
They're like, look, man, sometimes he's pissed all the time.
he's not always easy to get along with.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. He can be kind of harsh.
I don't know. But people talk like, that's kind of the way people talk about Ronnie James Dio, though, you know, or even Glenn Danzig. And I think it's just like, I'm in charge. My name is on this and I want it to be a certain way.
Yeah.
Which
I don't know tons of the history, like to give details and stuff, but I have to imagine that Dave always is kind of in I'm gonna show them mode too with everything. So he's like, look, this is the way it's gonna be because we're gonna fucking show them. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I would think there's always that underlying, you got kicked out, and they're always one step ahead of you all the time.
Yeah.
So I would be fucking irritated all the time too.
Yeah. Yeah,
and then you add substance abuse on top of that, and you have a personality that's probably at best hard to get along with.
Right. Yes. Oh yeah. I can't. You know. I don't know. Maybe the heroin addiction was like self conscious thing where like I kind of need to tamp myself down a little bit.
Oh sure. Know? Yeah.
where I'm clearly being awful. So
yeah. So I'm going to do this and maybe people will hang around to finish this album.
I'm going to do 100% of the smack in the immediate vicinity. Yeah. I think because you can't talk about Megadeth without touching base on Metallica.
No, the whole thing started with, hey, get the fuck out.
Yes.
I mean, that's, yeah. I mean, literally, they were in the middle of somewhere and said, you're not getting back on the truck with everyone else.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was drinking at that point. I don't think it was. I think heroin came a little bit later, but.
Yeah. I had always heard that's what it was at the time, is just uncontrollable binge drinking all of the time.
Yeah.
He was an angry drunk too. I hear.
Being around someone that drinks that way is real difficult.
Sure is.
They're exhausting is the best way to put it. I think.
Yeah.
I think, but it's strange though because Metallica forms in 81, and then we get Kill 'Em All in 83. You know, and obviously the No Life to Leather. The pre-Kill 'Em All release with Dave and Ron McGovney on it. But it's really interesting because
and Ron was the original bassist, right?
Yep. Yeah. And then we get so Kill 'Em All in 83, and I think that is the first of the big four albums.
Mm-hmm.
Now I can't rattle off Anthrax and Slayer's catalog right off the top of my head, but I think Anthrax released the first album the latest. I think they were the last ones, I believe. Because Anthrax was still kind of ramping up in 87, and Slayer, Megadeth, and Metallica were all pretty, you know, had their shit together, so to speak.
Yeah.
But when we get Killing Is My Business and Business Is Good in 84, 85, I think it's 85. It is 85. So Dave is, you know, bands take all of their lives to write that first album, and then they get to the second album, and then you know, they have to like, we got to get it done. So there's not always a lot of songs in the bank, so to speak.
Yeah. But, well, and I think too, that you get that first album and you get some recognition, and then all of a sudden people are saying, hey, you got to do that again.
Yeah.
Real quick. Yeah. You got to do that again.
Yeah, exactly. I think the hard thing, like if you could imagine being in Dave's shoes, is that he was starting over, you know, like from zero.
Yeah.
You know, he kept the mechanics, obviously, which is partially the Four Horsemen. You know, he kept that song, but like he had to start over. And Dave wasn't a singer. He was a lead guitarist.
No, they tried, like exhaustingly tried, to find someone to sing, and they finally gave up. And Dave said, okay, I'll do both.
Yeah. And which, weird at times. I mean, he's got such a unique voice. I can't hear Megadeth with another singer. You know what I mean?
No, me either. But I think part of his uniqueness and the way that he does sing, like, what do you mean?
Yeah.
That it becomes novel. And I think some of that is the reason that I kind of get tired of it after a while.
Oh, sure. Sure. It's almost melodramatic sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you listen, like, Master Five Magics, you know, when you listen to Rust in Peace, or like
that's funny though, because I do fucking like that song.
Dave, it's a good song.
Dave's got a great solo in that's a killer.
Yeah. The whole record is amazing, I think, but like it's just funny, you know. Hello, meet the real me. it's like I could see him be like, he's almost like a villain in a melodrama.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like with Dudley Do-Right.
You know? Yeah. And I think because of that, like I always picture him as like a multiple personality disorder. Mm-hmm. Like there's Dave, and then there's that guy that sings those songs. You know, it's like some kind of alternate personality. Like, move over, Dave. I'll sing this one for you.
Hello, me. Meet the real me and my misfits way of life. A dark black past is my most valued possession. Hindsight is always 20/20, but looking back, it's still a bit fuzzy. We speak of mutually assured destruction. Nice story. Tell your fears, get ya.
Feeling paranoid to win me your fostering. Anxiety's attacking me, my air is getting thin. I'm in trouble for the things I haven't got to yet. I'm chomping at the bit and my palms are getting wet.
He's a redhead, so it's like an evil leprechaun, you know?
Yeah.
You know, what is it? What is it? Is it Wayne's World? The I'm the leprechaun.
It is Wayne's World. Yeah.
I'm Dave Mustaine.
Yeah. I'm Dave Singer.
Can you remember the first time you heard him?
First time I heard Megadeth?
Yeah.
Probably same place I heard the rest of those fucking bands, is probably on Headbangers Ball.
It would have been probably around the time you were skating a bunch, right?
Yeah.
Wonder what I'm 7 years younger than you, so Countdown to Extinction was my first new Megadeth album.
Yeah, that was the first album where I listened to more than just whatever was on Headbangers Ball.
Sure.
For sure. But P-Cells was probably that was probably my very first exposure.
Oh, it was all over Headbangers Ball.
It was played a lot.
Yeah. I just remember I remember being in your bedroom when I was a kid and seeing it on the TV.
Mm-hmm.
I remember you had Derek had a Commodore 64.
Oh yeah, I did.
We had a like floppy disk. When you play a game, you put it in, then you got to put in the load.
Yeah, load, quote.
Yeah, whatever it is to get it. But anyway, he had a TV stand that him and Dad built that's real similar to the MTLB Ultra Mega recording desk. Like, it's very similar to that.
Yeah,
and TV. Commodore 64 on top of there. And I remember sitting at the foot of your bed watching that as you were probably playing Stratomatic or so, I don't know what you were doing, but I remember seeing P-Cells on the TV. And I specifically remember just all three, Chris, Dave, and Junior, other Dave, just kind of like heads bobbing up and down to the rhythm of the song. And I remember, I think that's the video where they have like B-roll news footage of war and stuff like that.
Yeah, it was kind of grainy and
there
was some fucking mushroom clouds and stuff in the background and
standard thrash metal, you know.
Yeah.
Visuals.
Yeah.
They're like Countdown to Extinction, because I didn't get into P-Cells until I was a teenager. I think I had to have been 17 before I really discovered that album and liked it. But Countdown to Extinction was the big album. And I think it's just a strange album. You know what I mean? Like, when you listen to the rest of the catalog, it's not
quite as thrashy. And I think production wise, it's a higher, I don't know because I'm not a production guy, but it sounds like a higher tier production quality.
Oh, sure.
And the bottom end is a little more heavy. It's a little more punchy. So it came out and I think it was a much bolder sound, but also maybe a little more friendly, not subject matter wise, but friendly to listen to people that weren't like metalheads like we were. It was a little, I guess, maybe a little more radio friendly.
Stuff. Well, so, I mean, I know they got a Grammy nod on Rust in Peace. They didn't win it, and I think they got one again on Countdown to Extinction. I don't think they won it. I think they've been up for a couple Grammys, but I mean, that alone tells you. You know, the fact that they made it all the way to the Grammys.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's 1992, you know, it's just that stuff was so quickly changing at that time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have the alt boom happening by that point. And just, I don't know. The album is, there's parts of Megadeth's catalog that it's almost like, I feel like I'm watching a farce. You know?
Yeah.
This is
No, I think Emma and Casey just got home.
Oh, okay.
They just Casey rode a Tauntaun in to pick up Emma from
Emma.
It's all the way ridiculous out here where we live.
Derek's got a black dog named Cole that is about the size of a Tauntaun.
You can't see our driveway or anything right now. It's fucking ridiculous outside.
It's amazing. I love it. I love it. I think it's incredible. I
fucking hate it.
When I got up this morning, I was like, oh, it's gonna snow today. You know. Yeah. I gotta listen to Gorga Roth. I love it. Frigid, you know, frigid, frozen Norway.
Shit. I hate it. I hate it. All it does is make my life less convenient all the time. I fucking hate it.
What, snow or black metal?
Yeah. snow.
Yeah, Derek doesn't like black metal.
I don't like black metal, but I don't hate it. I fucking hate snow.
Okay. That's further than we were 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're coming around.
I am coming along. I'm coming along. I hate winter more than black metal.
You said you did like a week long deep dive.
I did. I listened to a lot of shit.
Are you doing, what are you doing, Spotify?
Yeah, I'll go on Spotify. Spotify, if you want to quick hear somebody's kind of like a sampling of their entire catalog, you type in anybody's name and always this little thing pops up that says, this is Megadeth. And it'll be, you know, 30 songs out of across their whole catalog. I don't know if somebody, you know, I don't know if they do it by this is all these songs got the most listens or whatever it is.
Sure.
Right. It's a pretty good snippet of their whole catalog.
Did you do albums? Did you do full albums?
Yeah. I listened to full albums and also
you actually did it. You waded through albums.
No, fuck. I couldn't make it through all of them. No, there's some of them that I'm like, okay, I'm gonna stick to this one. I'll get like four songs deep and I'm like, I can't fucking take this anymore. What's the next song?
Dude, I think the Peace Cells is my favorite one. It's the one I listen to the most.
Yeah.
A lot of it's because of Good Morning Black Friday, you know, and The Conjuring too.
Those are good songs. I have two albums that are my favorite. One, Rust in Peace is my favorite just because that's in my opinion, that's the best album as far as the whole album goes. Like, I like that album the best. It's the most thrashy. And then what were we just talking about? Countdown
to Extinction.
It's my other one. And that one might be more nostalgic than anything because I was in art school. That album came out. It was brand new. And I remember sitting in my room. You know, you remember when I used to sit up there and I'd pull all-nighters. I'd start one piece and work on it without stopping for 24, 36 hours straight. And I would just let Countdown play again and again and again and again and again. Kind of zone out into my own art world.
What do you think? You've always done that though. I know. I don't think I've ever seen you draw without music playing.
I don't ever remember drawing without music playing.
Do you think was there something about that album that clicked your, you know, made the internal gears line up?
I don't know. I don't know that. I know when that album came out, I was immediate because I'm really visual, so I was really attracted to the cover, the old guy hovering in the air, and then the single like rectangular shaped window behind him with the blue sky outside, but it's all gray and dark and dim inside the room where he's at, and it almost looks like a prison cell or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the thing it makes me think of, I know you're not into death metal, but there's a band called Morbid Angel, right?
And yeah, I've heard of them.
Yeah, they had this big song called God of Emptiness. It was a video on Beavis and Butthead. And there's a creepy old man that's turning into, I guess, the god of emptiness, I suppose. And to me, the old man on the cover of Countdown to Extinction looks like the old man in the God of Emptiness video. And I remember when I was young watching Beavis and Butthead, I was like, hey, is this a counterpart to Countdown to Extinction?
Yeah, these go together.
Is this Megadeth? Yeah. Like, that guy doesn't look like Dave Mustaine.
Yeah.
I think it's, I don't know. Yeah.
I used you remember me airbrushing all the time.
Oh yeah.
You remember that big hornet that I drew? I used that window from that Megadeth cover as like one of the elements of that piece. Cool.
When we get done, give me a picture of that, because I can throw it up on the screen.
Oh, okay. I have to dig that one out. It's filed away in a box somewhere, but
Interesting. It's interesting what, kind of like from an artistic standpoint, it's neat. It's really interesting, the different things that sort of give you that, you know, push you, you know, forward. From an artistic standpoint, like for me, for the longest time, especially when I was drawing and painting all the time, it was old Def Leppard. You know, like, and you've seen some of the shit I draw, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Your shit and Def Leppard don't go together.
right. Like I draw disturbing things, but at the same time, I'm like, hello, America. Hello, America. I don't know. It worked for some reason. It's odd. It's really, yeah,
don't you think some of it though is, at least for me, I don't know about you, but there's some stuff you listen to and you don't have to pay attention to it necessarily. So it more helps you get into like kind of a flow state.
You concentrate. I think that's why, you know, anything that I've done, it doesn't matter what, that if I can listen to music while I'm doing it, I'm good.
Yeah. Same.
I'm good.
Yeah. You can ask me to go count rocks in the fucking driveway. And as long as I got some music, I'll count the fucking rocks and I'll be all right with it.
Yeah. I remember when I was doing, wrapping up my EMT certification, it was just unreal. It was just back to back Judas Priest, Kiss, Dawkins. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just end over end. And like, I memorized like a lot of my anatomy and physiology to Dawkins, you know, like it was just like fucking, we are the dream warriors. I'll be like, that is the vena cava.
Yep, for sure.
This is your pulmonary, you know, that sort of stuff. So, I don't know. It's weird. I don't have like a Megadeth like creative trigger though.
That album Countdown for me is, it just, like I said, it's nostalgic. It takes me right back to college, right back to staying up all night in my room.
Right.
And it's the same with the Black album. It was the exact same way for Metallica's Black album. I waited. That album came out, and then that was the soundtrack to a lot of fucking drawings I have around here.
Right.
But so, you just put it in and zone out and
you go.
But and on Countdown, there's for the most part, I can just let that album play and I don't pay attention to it. But there's a couple songs on there that every time I'm like, oh wait, turn this one up.
You know? Sure. For me, Architecture of Aggression is probably, that's one for me. Like, I love that song.
Yeah.
I like the lyrics of it, especially now, like all the guys were contributing, mm-hmm. On the album. Now, obviously everything kind of funnels back to Dave. But all the guys in the band at that time were contributing from a songwriting standpoint, and lyrics wise, I don't know if it's a Dave lyric or whoever. I don't know, but the idea that you can be recognized for how you destroy, You know what I mean? Like the way, sure. The way you destroy something is, it's almost like your calling card.
Yeah.
I think Ellefson, I think Junior was the first one to get clean between the two of them, I believe. And he stayed clean. I know Dave has had a couple relapses. There was one in the 90s that was bad. And I think he got post-surgery. I think it was when his hand, I remember it was like some sort of like neuropathy where the nerves weren't doing whatever nerves need to do. Yeah. And he had his hand, he was in a lot of pain, so he had to take painkillers and it triggered him. And he went down the I'm assuming the opiate rabbit hole, I guess. But you know, it's scary because like we've seen it a lot of times, you know, like Anthony Kiedis is a good example where just like sometimes Anthony was like, I'm gonna do heroin.
Yeah, I'm going to go do all the drugs again.
I got, let's get some heroin, you guys. Mm-hmm. You know,
like, hey, we haven't done that in a while. Right. What do you want to do? You know, what we haven't done in a while. Smack. Let's do that.
You know, it sounds awesome. Hot dogs, black tar heroin.
Yes.
How do you want your hot dog? Can you cut it up and just put ketchup all over it?
And then on the side, on the side, could it just, you know, just mainline a just.
I'm glad he's, because I think he's sober.
As far as I know, he's sober. Well, there was a cancer scare too, right? Recently, that was in the last like few years.
Oh, there was. Yeah.
Well, I think it was more than a scare. I think he had cancer and he got treatments and everything. And then part of that was his jujitsu that he had started.
Oh, yeah. How deep is he into it? Do you know?
I think he's been he's somewhere between 3 and 5 years. And he's got a purple belt already, which is pretty impressive in that amount of time. But he's got some instructors that are big time. I mean, Dave's not learning from Joe Jiu-Jitsu down the street. He's
right. Well, because everybody, Derek is pretty, I would say more than balls deep into Jiu-Jitsu. Maybe rib cage deep into Jiu-Jitsu, but in relation to you, where is he at?
He is 2 belts above me. I'm a 4-stripe white belt, about to be blue. Okay. And then after blue is purple. So let's say my blue belt's a month away. Maybe whenever we do promotions next, I'm probably going to get my blue belt. I would assume, but I'm 3 years in. So it's taken me 3 years to get to the next color of belt.
Okay. All right.
And on average, a black belt, you're looking at 10 years.
Okay. All right. Got it. I got it. I don't have no like no like barometer for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just in my head I was able to punch through 5 bricks. So I'm X color of belt.
Yeah.
next year I will punch through 10 bricks.
Yeah. And that's a way a lot of the martial arts are. You know, you learn a form, and once you know that, then okay, that's all you needed to know for this color belt. Now you can move to the next one. Right. Jiu-jitsu is a much, much more long and drawn out process. It's slow, very, very slow.
Yeah, I would think that probably weeds out sort of like casual interlopers pretty quickly, if I had to guess.
Yeah, 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 it does. They say that a lot of people will make it to their blue belt, and then that's where most people drop out is at blue belt, which is really the first color of belt that, okay, now you've learned that you don't know shit about jiu-jitsu. now you can start actually learning about jiu-jitsu.
Okay. Wow. Good Lord. I don't like being touched. I hate it.
And the other thing too, it's simply what's impressive about Dave having his purple belt is it is incredibly hard on your body. Incredibly hard on your body.
Yeah. I think he was born in 60 something.
Yeah.
Yeah. 61, I think.
Yes. He's got 10 plus years on me. And I mean, that's impressive for him to have reached a purple belt at that age. That's impressive. I mean, that alone lets you know he's a tough motherfucker. I mean, that's a tough dude. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's impressive either way. I think, I wonder if that's, I would think that it would be, because I've, you know, you and I talk about, well, this is going in an interesting direction, but you and I talk about like healthy masculinity, you know, and if anybody sees like my personal social media, you know, I'm adamant about sort of embracing healthy masculinity, you know, that sort of thing. I'm wondering if the jiu-jitsu keeps that ugly side of Dave in check.
I can tell you from personal experience, and the wife and the kids will tell you the same thing, that dad gets really fucking grumpy if he doesn't go to class. and it helps that tendency for violence is it's worked out at class 3 times a week. I mean, I do about 8 to 10 hours a week, and I stay in a pretty good mood most of the time, but it's medicine for sure. It's medicine. And you exhaust yourself in such a way that there's not a lot left. And when you're rolling in class, you're not thinking about all your troubles and woes or who pissed you off today. There's
sure.
You're focused in on this guy's trying to fucking choke me right now. So
yeah. Yeah.
So I would imagine it's probably been some super good therapy for him.
Yeah, it's interesting. In my head, I just pictured him like choking Marty Friedman out, you know, like I didn't like the guitar solo.
Yep.
choking Marty out, like getting me like a rear naked choke, and like just having him like on the floor on a stage. The crowd is just, you know, what happened? Like, yeah. Dave hated the solo. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. I mean, he ever since my first exposure to him, even when he was younger and you would see him on TV, he seemed so fucking mad all the time. Just like so mad all the time. And I always just blamed it on Metallica. I'm like, well, he did get kicked out of fucking Metallica. That would piss me off too. So
yeah, that's, oh man. Do you have any idea how badly that would sting?
Oh, and not, that's not like a, yeah, that hurt, but I'm over it. Like I don't imagine he's all the way over it yet.
Oh no, there's no fucking way.
No, because Metallica, whether you like them or you hate them, they are arguably the biggest out of the thrash bands.
Well, they're the one of the biggest heavy bands on the ever.
Yeah, ever. You know, and ever, as far as being like catapulted into absolute superstardom. I mean, they are at the top as far as all of those bands go. I mean, they had the most success for sure. Yeah. And he had to fucking watch that his entire career.
Well,
he had
to watch that. But I mean, it's funny because this came up, you know, I follow kind of like maybe a theologian, psychologist guy named Jordan Peterson. And Jordan Peterson was talking about the head game that would go along with, you know, someone that was angry enough to at a prior situation was so angry that it fueled him to be in one of the most successful bands ever.
Yeah.
It just so happens the band he got booted from was another one of the biggest.
Was more successful.
and the chances of both of those things happening is so astronomically high that it's almost infinitely impossible that that would occur. You know, mm-hmm. It's just, if it was me looking back at the Metallica catalog, I don't know that I would mind at this point.
Not at this point. I would say after the Black Album, and the Black Album was a big difference between that Black Album and everything else prior.
Right.
Even Injustice for All, I think, was different than the prior three. And then the Black Album was way different. Everything after that was at least to me, complete fucking horseshit. And then, but Megadeth, some of their albums, I'm like, yeah, a lot of their catalog, I'm like, there's a lot of fucking great songs. But I think that overall, musically, they stayed a lot more consistent throughout their career. It's still the same kind of sound.
Megadeth.
And the song. Yeah, absolutely. Everybody changes for sure, but I don't know that they ever had that drastic of a change. Like, well, not like Metallica did.
Well, I mean, Risk. You know, in 1999, it's like Risk is to Megadeth like the Elder is to Kiss. Like, it is a fucking herpes blister on an otherwise perfect penis.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like
most people with any kind of longevity, though.
I just made that.
Everybody has that one.
I just made that comparison, by the way.
A herpes blister.
A herpes blister on an otherwise perfect penis. Put it on a shirt.
Yeah, this is a really great cock. Oh. I didn't notice, but if you look at the backside. Turns out. don't you think though that all of the bands at some point have a herpes blister somewhere?
Yeah, well, not Judas Priest.
I'll have to agree with that one.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's no herpes blisters on Judas Priest. That is an outstanding cock. What a fantastic metal penis you have.
I don't know if I can put this on Facebook.
We might have to put a warning on this one. There's a lot of cock talk on this episode.
We'll have Carter do a t-shirt.
Yeah.
With that. Whew, that made me sweat. Hold on, I'm covering up the furnace bit. It's too hot. Okay. All right. Yeah. Yeah. Risk is bad. Risk is bad, man.
It's bad.
They were that was the one with Goldberg in the video. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do now. Yeah. 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 I totally forgot. I've forgotten all about that.
It was awful, man. Is it as awful as Load?
Yes.
I don't think
I don't think Load is as awful.
But I think it's as awful as Saint Anger, though.
I don't know that anything is as awful as Saint Anger.
Herpes.
Not as bad as Saint Anger.
You can't. Saint Anger is like herpes because you can't you can't unhear it. You know?
Yeah, like, it just occasionally like, it pops up again, and you're like, "Fuck, okay, I'm out this week."
We did an episode on it on the Music the Lifeblood podcast a couple years ago, and I listened to it, you know, because I was really diving into the album, and I'm not even joking; it gave me a migraine.
It's so bad. It is. It's fucking awful. It's just noise. It is so terrible.
You live it, love it. You live it, you love it.
It's so bad.
My lifestyle. It's
so fucking bad.
What is it? My lifestyle. What is it? Meets my death style. Is that what it is? My lifestyle meets my death style.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so bad. Like I don't know those guys on any kind of personal level, but I was all the way fucking embarrassed for them. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yeah.
It was awful. Awful.
Yeah. But it
pissed me off too, because I've been such a huge Metallica fan, and I was like, I was so excited. There was some new shit coming out. And then I'm like, are you fucking kidding me with this bullshit?
I'm so mad. I've compared Metallica to the literary archetype of the trickster. In that, you know, the trickster, like, ooh, here's Ride the Lightning. Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh. And then, guess
what? Like,
you know, Saint Anger. You know, like I picture, like, what is it? Midsummer Night's Dream with the donkey bottom. You know, I'm like, it's like, you're playing horrible tricks on me and I hate it. You know, I don't want any part of this. And like all the while Metallica's like jokes and japes. You know, our drummer can't play really well. You know, it's just, I can't. No. Yes. I think Risk is as bad as Saint Anger. Absolutely. Yeah,
it's bad.
It's terrible. But everything after that, though, because not long after that, I don't know when, like I said, I don't have the catalog dialed in, but Dave Ellison is like, no. even Marty and Nick were like, no. And then eventually Dave was like, no.
Yeah.
And then Dave's, I think, that thing with Dave's hand happened where he... You know, the neuropathy where he couldn't play. And he was like, I guess I'm done being Megadeth. So I can't play guitar anymore. But then a couple of years later, it was like, okay, here we go. Yeah. I think it was like everything from The World Needs a Hero to through Super Collider. It's just a big like of stuff I don't care about.
Yeah.
You know, and I kind of hate being that guy where I'm all like, I don't care. You know,
well, yeah, but that's kind of how they make me feel too. I'm like, I really dig this shit up to a point, and then I'm like, I'm done. I don't want to do it anymore. Yeah.
But I think that's kind of the natural progression of things.
Yeah, I think they all get to that point where you're all like, you're kind of worn it out now.
Yeah, I'm that way with Iron Maiden. Like, I haven't liked much of anything after Dance of Death, and I feel kind of bad about it, you know?
I always feel bad because you like these bands so much, and there's so much good stuff, and you really, like, even to the point where I'm trying to convince myself to like something when I know that it's shitty. I'm like, no, dude, it's good. Just keep listening. Maybe you're going to like it. And I'm like, I don't like it.
But I can't.
Yeah. Cause we've had the conversation before where you're all like, look, they were so great. They should have just quit right here. They should have quit.
Yeah.
And they would have been fucking fantastic.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm that way with System of a Down. If you guys just quit before the first album, that would be great.
Yeah. If you know, would have not ever, we would have liked to. We would have fucking loved you.
I love those guys when I didn't know who they were.
Yeah. You
know?
Yeah.
I hate that band, dude. I hate them.
They just seem like such fucking pricks, too.
It's, yeah. It comes across as being try hard and pretentious.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very, very try hard and pretentious. And that guitar player, Darren, I've never seen a guitar player that so badly wanted to be something more than the guitar player, but just needed to stay the guitar player.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, okay, seeing a little backup, that's fine. But the guy, everybody else likes the fuzzy haired fella.
Yeah, the fuzzy guy.
We like, he sings real funny. I like him. He's mm-hmm. good, you know. But I can't do System, man. I can't do it. It's always a cool feeling when you know you've exposed someone to something. You know what I mean? That they had an encounter before. It's always a really, really cool feeling.
Yeah, something that was not only like a new discovery, but kind of a game changer where they took notice of something that they might not have otherwise.
Yeah, yeah, it's a neat feel. It's a really neat feeling. That's the we got to look at some comments here in a second. But that's one of the things that I always talk about when it comes to old school record store culture, quote unquote. You know, you've experienced this. I remember being in One Music with you in Muncie and Karma Records. And, you know, you see a CD or a record and you're like, what's this sound like? And the people behind the counter know what's going on with it. You know, they end up telling you about, yeah, they've got two other albums before this. Here's what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, that sort of exchange of information.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That people used to have in record stores.
Yeah, or they... I remember guys saying, well, have you ever heard of this guy or this band or this band? I'm like, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like, if you take them and mix it with these guys, that's kind of what these guys sound like. And you're like, fuck, okay.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. I remember like that was the most time. Like, I remember going to the Karma Records in Muncie. It was across from the Muncie Mall for the longest time. And I remember going in there, and that was the first time I heard someone say Motorhead.
Oh, yeah.
I was looking at something and they said, yeah, it sounds a little bit like Motorhead. And I'm like, what's Motorhead? And all of a sudden, you know, there's the 77 album in my hands, you know, and I listened to the song Motorhead, you know, just about, you know, I need to close my eyes, even if it's just an hour, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. So just to play off of that, like, my whole exposure to Motorhead was just Ace of Spades. So then when you started listening to more than that, and then you introduced me to that, I'm like, holy fuck, Ace of Spades, that song is not, that's not where it's at. Have you heard this other shit?
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
so good. Yeah. yeah. It's that whole kind of thing.
It's just neat. Cause it's a domino effect, you know. It's kind of like paying it forward. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, where you try to turn somebody else onto something good. I remember that's how I discovered the Misfits. You know, you and I there's a member of our family, and his friend during high school was really into a band, Black Flag. And that's how I got turned on to Black Flag. And then I borrowed Henry Rollins's, his copy of Henry Rollins Get in the Van. It's his, it's like his diary entries from the time he was in Black Flag.
Yeah.
And there's just this one rant. I'll put it up on the screen so you guys can see it. I've talked about this in an episode of Vinyl Thursday once. So I think it was the episode I talked about Doyle's Instagram, because he was telling really neat stories on his Instagram. But there is this, this picture of the Misfits in their playing show, you know, somewhere. And I looked at that picture and I was like, what the hell is this?
Yeah.
You know, what is this? And that's, and then boom, that's how I went down that rabbit hole. You know, I go to Karma, you know, the next weekend, and I buy collection 2 by the Misfits. And that's where I heard Children in Heat, We Bite, Horror Hotel, Return of the Fly, like all of those songs. That's how I got exposed to the Misfits. And like, there's a certain part of music, the Lifeblood, that, you know, I don't like, you know, for lack of a better term, branding, you know, the Misfits is a huge part of music, the Lifeblood. And I wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't be like, I've interviewed a ton of the guys that were in the band, you know, mm-hmm. what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I, like sometimes, like when I flip through the contacts on my phone, I see like his numbers in my phone, you know what I mean? Like, it's just a weird, weird feeling, you know, especially when you think back to just being like, well, who's that? You know, the, just the personal distance, the mileage that you put in as a person in between. It's fascinating.
Yeah. It is. And I kind of touched on it earlier, but you just mentioned again, what I think, how art and music go together so well is that, that whole don't judge a book by its cover, but we do that a lot. And especially with like these early 80s metal bands, everybody had like, everybody had an artist that did most of their stuff. And like, everybody had a mascot, you know, like Iron Maiden had Eddie, and Megadeth had their own skull guy.
Vic Rattle.
Yeah. And so all of that artwork, like for you, like the Misfits, you had seen a poster or an album cover or something. You're like, the fuck is that? And that drew us in. And then that turned you on to the music. And then because of that, then you see other kind of similar artworks and you're like, well, maybe that's another band that's around the same thing. And to me, it's neat how it all ties together and just pulls us in all the time.
Speaking of Vic Rattlehead for Megadeth, I was looking at Ed Repka's online store a couple weeks ago. I think, I don't know if I sent it to you. It might've been like before I went to bed or something, but his artwork is very affordable.
Oh, really?
You know, like really affordable. I was genuinely taken aback by like, I could buy 3 of these comfortably, you know?
Yeah. It's so, so good too. Between Eddie and then Rattlehead, that there's some of the coolest fucking images that you've ever seen. So cool.
Well, the cover of Peace Sells, like, I know you're not with the faith, I guess, when it comes to that album, but
no, I'm a
Rest in Peace. I mean, Ed Repka did it too. You know,
mm-hmm.
I think that just the cover of Peace Sells is so striking to me, you know, because it, you know, it's really neat because the Reagan 80s, you know, sort of it runs in tandem with the development of the thrash as a genre.
Yeah.
It was very, very important to the way that genre of music sort of moved and its beats and its pacing and, you know, just things like that. The sociological biology that is the backdrop to the entire career of Megadeth, you know, mm-hmm. I don't know that Dave Mustaine is an angry guy, like you said, but he seems angry.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I sometimes wonder if he seems angry just because of the 80s was otherwise a fairly, you know, there was a, you know, job employment was on, you know, the incline, you know, the people were still making good money at that time. Mm-hmm. You know, it just, things were not as bad. And I say that because of coming out of Vietnam, Richard Nixon, you know, and Gerald Ford being like, we have to get past this. So I'm going to pardon the fuck. And we're just going to go on about our lives because we need to get past it. So I think the 80s sort of like embodied that moving on and, you know, let's sort of have a good time again. You know what I mean? And you saw with as far as like, you know, we talked about the class of 1985 a couple episodes ago, and you saw that in that hair band scene, that decade was really about just going back to the party. You know?
It was excess. It was,
let's
fucking have fun and go party.
That's right. Right. And the thrash, I think the thrash scene, because it has its roots are tied directly to punk rock and early hardcore and stuff like that, mm-hmm. because you don't get thrash without the collision of metal and punk rock, obviously.
Yeah.
And it's just interesting to think that is Dave Mustaine angry or is he just providing a foil? Is he the unintended foil to the backdrop of the decade?
Mm-hmm.
It's neat to think about in that regard, but I don't know. Rest in Peace is really good.
It's fucking great album.
It's interesting that it came out in 1990 though. So, you know, when the decade changes, everything else gets, you know, kind of,
yeah, because it, so. Yeah, because stuff went willy nilly right then. That's,
yes,
that's
when, it did.
That's
yes,
when
exactly
shit went to hell.
yes yeah, well I think it started going to hell. I mean, obviously when you talk about the 80s and 90s you have to talk about AIDS.
Yeah. You know,
and I think that was a very sobering thing for mm-hmm. most people, and I think there's, you know, I don't think it's a tenuous connection. I think it's a very strong direct connection that the AIDS epidemic, the impact of that had on the alt bands that mm-hmm. went supernova after that, because I think that was the point where kind of everybody went to college and they got a bit more socially conscious and they knew that it just wasn't about, you know, life is about more than, you know, yeah. just going, yeah. you know, the next girl and going to a party, that sort of thing. So,
yeah. Well, I think a lot of it was all of a sudden like, look, all of this fun we've been having, there's repercussions.
There's consequences. Yeah.
Yes, for sure. Yeah. We went wild and now look what's happening. Maybe this wasn't the best idea.
Yeah. It's scary. But I mean, I remember seeing Dave on MTV doing Choose or Lose segments.
Oh yeah.
You know, him interviewing people. Like I could have swore like he was talking to some politicians at some point, you know, like I think that is indicative of Dave being, he's more than just angry, and he has always been more than just angry.
Yeah, I agree. I don't know. I think probably Dave himself's got a lot of anger just because of what happened, but I think a lot of what we see there was just the social consciousness of him. And him seeing what was going on and having something to say about it. Not necessarily that he was pissed, but like, look, this is what's going on in the fucking world right now. And I kind of feel like it's fucked up. So.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting. His whole career arc, man. It's fascinating. It's just fascinating.
I mean, he's an interesting guy for sure.
All right. You want to look at some comments?
Yeah, let's see him.
It's time to look at some comments.
Derek, if you reference the infamous chat betwixt the three gents that make Music the Lifeblood go, you'll see that I have scoured the dirty depths of the YouTube comment section under assorted Megadeth music videos and live performances. I have dredged the filthy waters, the human refuse of the internet. First comment, Derek.
Okay, this is by Surya Yamamandra.
All right, good name.
Comment, how hard do you want to make the riffs in the song? Megadeth responds by simply saying, yes. Yes. We want them to be all of the hard.
All hard.
All hard.
All of the hardness we wanted. And that, and, I mean, it's the fucking truth.
It is.
Dave Mustaine's lead play or rhythm playing is better than like fucking Yngwie Malmsteen's leads. You know, like it's just jaw-dropping.
Like how many times did people say, Dave, I thought you were playing the rhythm part, and he's like, yeah. Yeah, fucking learn it.
You fucking see this red hair? Yeah. That means I'm Dave Mustaine.
Yeah, fucking Dave Mustaine. Right now I'm super pissed off that you're not learning this rhythm part.
I mean he's got Marty, you know, or he had Marty, you know. The new guy, Kiko, he's real good. I think he's Brazilian, maybe. He's real pretty. He's really pretty.
Well, yeah, I think you'd have to be named Kiko.
Right. What does that even mean?
You can't have that. You can't have that name unless you're pretty.
What's that name mean?
Pretty.
You know what it means.
Yeah, you know what it means.
He's like he looks like he could be like an elf in Lord of the Rings. You know, he's like that pretty.
Yeah, he's magical looking.
He's mad. All right, next one.
Next one. This is by Gamed Out Gamer.
Good name.
When your Coke habit cuts the wardrobe budget.
that's the Holy Wars video, isn't it?
Yes.
No one has a shirt. It's
yeah.
And they're all sweaty, and it's really interesting because the camera like circles around the band the entire video, and they're all like they're on a square stage, and they're all on one side, no shirt, facing out, just playing their riffs.
Yeah,
you know,
this one's a military looking picture though. It's got the crosshairs and what looks to be like a giant tank or something.
Oh, that's one of the flashes.
Yeah.
The flashes of the pictures. There's, I think. They edited in like, as with most Megadeth videos, there's edited in little flashes of just war, you know? Yeah.
So this next one is where you were going. it's fucking great. Okay. This is by Makedus, and the director says, what shirts you guys want to wear? Megadeth responds, no. No shirts.
I just think it's funny because they're all just like David Ellefson really is like playing to the camera. He's like, he's got his chest puffed out and he's hitting his, you know, fucking.
Yeah. It looks like he even has a little bit of a ooh face going on, maybe. you fucking like that, huh?
Does Dave Ellefson make the yes face or the no face?
And then if it gets real nasty, he'll say no. No.
I love the no face. It's my favorite. Yeah. Have you ever seen my Pantera face?
Let's see it.
You want to see it?
Yeah, let's see the Pantera face. Bro, bro, Blow load up. Fuck yeah. Those were all the like Robitussin'd out kids from school. They would hear that fucking riff and immediately all of them in unison would have that face.
No, this.
Yeah.
Guzzle yep. With Tussin.
Chugging down Tussin. Fucking robed out.
Dude, Robo Trippin' is no joke. I've seen it.
I've seen it
up front, and I've
my senior class in high school consumed monumentous amounts of Robitussin.
It's like, I don't know. We both like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. The quote is something to the effect, there's nothing more depraved than the man in the throes of an ether binge or something like that. I don't know. Something like that. Like he says a hellishly intense introspective nightmare at one point. And I feel like that's like Midwestern robo tripping, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It was bad.
Was it codeine? Bad. Is it codeine?
Yeah.
Is that what's
I on? Think so. Yeah. 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 And for the longest time, I didn't know how big of a problem it was, but I remember when you no longer could go to the store and buy Robitussin. it was behind the counter. You had to ask for it now, and you had to have an ID. And so there's older dudes that just seriously got a fucking bad cold and they need some goddamn Robitussin and you can't buy it anymore. You know, like guys like that were just fucking pissed. Because you can't go, like, what the fuck? Where's the cough syrup
at? Well, it's funny because, like, I remember you worked at a grocery store when you were young for the longest time. And
like,
that's probably firsthand experience.
Oh, yeah. You know? We had to pull it all off the shelves and it was up in the office. You had to ask for that shit. and then I'd have knuckleheads that I went to school with. They're like, hey, can you get me some Tussin? And I'm like, no, you fucker. I'm not getting you any Tussin. And if you keep it up, I'm going to tell my mom. And when you go to your fucking meeting next week with my mom, she's going to know that you relapsed all fucking week.
That's an actual scenario. Our mom was, she was a therapist.
Yeah,
you know, she specialized in, you know, diagnostics when it came to psych issues and addictions. That was her main gig, which I can't imagine, like, because I mean, by the point I, like, when I was at that age where friends had started smoking pot, drinking, taking LSD and stuff like that, I you had worn her down to a nub, you know. Because you were fucking awful.
Fucking was not. Jesus Christ.
You were terrible as a teenager. Like, you were just like, oh God, you were awful, man. I can't count how many nights watching you at the top of the stairs, you know, in the upstairs of our house, just leaning,
getting a 2.5 hour psych evaluation while I was leaning on the stairway.
Fucking mom chewing you out from the recliner in the living room, and dad just like eating brownies. You
know? Yeah,
eating those cupcakes.
Probably turned his fucking hearing aid down so he didn't have to listen to it. He's like, God damn it.
I remember just like being in my room being like, I'm not going through that. I'm not doing it. You know,
it was so awful. So awful. You know how many times I just wish, like, I wanted to trade the 2 hour psyche vow for just a good fucking beating from dad. I'm like, kid, can I just take a fucking hammering from the old man and skip this whole thing?
I don't think it would have been as effective though, you know.
No.
You know, wouldn't have been as effective. I mean, I got it too. I got it too, but
yeah. But what was good is it was really good training for the both of us because we got a pretty good handle on psychology and people in general.
Yeah, you know? True. I think, but I fought back way harder than what you did, and I think it came to a draw. You know, after a while, and mom was like, he's not getting arrested. We're good. Just let him go. No, I remember it was like my first major date. And, so I go out and we, whatever. And I go back to the girl's house, and mom had told me before I left, it was like, all right, be home by midnight. 12:30 rolls around. I call mom and said, I'm not coming home. And that's just how it went from there.
Yeah, because I had already caused them to throw in the towel. They were like, fuck it. I cannot go through it again.
Yeah.
Just let him run.
I think it was easier. I know that the conversation had to have happened. I know it had to have happened where mom said to dad, can you physically overcome Dustin? And I think dad would have went, we got to call Derek. I got bigger than everybody really quickly.
Yeah.
It was weird. Yeah. All right. Anyway. All right. Back to the comments.
Okay. Next one. Ricardo Ordaz says, and there's a picture. I'm not gay at all, but Elfson was so hot. It just said, he's just fucking pointing his guitar.
He's good looking. Look, the dudes in Megadeth are good looking.
They are not the ugliest band, for sure.
No, they are not. Ratio-wise, I think they're hotter than Metallica.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
They're absolutely better looking than Anthrax. You know, with Anthrax, like Danny Spitz is like 5 foot tall, you know, like Joey Belladonna's too tan.
Yeah, he's a handsome fella, though.
Is he?
Yeah, I think so. Don't you think?
I think he looks like he tans too much. Like,
well, he does, but he's not. I mean, he's a bit leathery.
Yeah, a bit leathery.
A handsome guy, though, right?
Scott Ian is balding, you know?
Yeah, no, Scott, everyone likes Scott, but none of the chick. You don't have to worry about your girlfriend around Scott.
Yeah, and Danny Spitz is like 5 foot tall.
Yeah.
You know, and Charlie's just goofy haired.
Yeah.
This doesn't work. Yeah. But I think he's with Carla from the Butcher Babies now, though.
Really?
Yeah, I think they're an item.
Is there quite the age difference there?
A bit.
Yeah.
But I don't think it matters.
Who cares? I'm not sure it matters in life. Yeah, I mean, everybody gets past 25, 26, then whatever.
Yeah, you're all dumb.
Yeah, everyone's stupid, so. And the guys, we don't stop being stupid till like 45.
Right. Yeah.
We continue to be dumb for a long time.
Agree. hence this podcast. So, yeah. All right. All right. What's the next one?
I think this might be the last one. Nate B says, the sound of the snare drum arouses me sexually. Sexually.
I don't even remember getting that one.
Yeah. I just think it's funny how he separated the sentence. It says, the sound of the snare drum arouses me, period. Sexually.
as opposed to
I don't know what else arousal has.
I don't even remember seeing that one. That's awesome. Yeah, I think that was that's probably Nick Menza's snare drum, probably.
Yeah.
He's kind of the Megadeth drummer, you know. Yeah. He's the one. They got a new guy now. His name is Dirk Verburen. I think that's what it is. He played in Soilwork. And we all know Soilwork and that their songs are impossible to play and understand sometimes.
He's the new guy on Dystopia. Is he the newest?
No, he's not. Do you not know who played on Dystopia?
No, I don't.
This is Chris Adler from Lamb of God.
Fuck off. No wonder I like the drums to that one.
I mean, he didn't do all that stuff that he does with Lamb of God, no. But I mean,
No, but now you say that, I think I remember. I'm pretty sure I remember that note now. I'm upset that Chris Adler's not playing drums for Lamb of God anymore.
Yeah. That bums me.
Lamb of God, one of my other most favorite bands of all time.
What's your favorite album?
From Lamb of God?
Yeah.
Maybe Ashes.
Ashes of the Wake?
Yeah.
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 That's a good album. I think that was the first thing I heard him. Is that the one with, oh, let me show you all that I have mastered?
Yeah, I think so. There's so many good songs. I just, that band is, they arouse me. Sexually. That was so good. I was listening to Omuerta on the way to work, and the drums in that song.
Oh yeah,
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, yeah. I think
there's like doubles and triples, and it's his feet are pretty incredible.
Yes, they are. Whole different kind of technique that no one was doing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just, oh God. I mean, it's cliche, but I remember the first time hearing Ruin and I just remember going, what is
that? Yeah. Yeah. What's that?
Is this Neil Peart's new band?
That was one of the ones where you had, no matter where you're at, you have to say, everyone shut up for a second. Listen.
Stop talking.
Yeah, stop talking. Something is happening.
What do you think is the most sexy song?
Like in metal, the most sexy song in metal?
I guess.
I don't know. If you're talking about just like a good baby maker. I mean, Great White's got some good baby makers.
I say Lay It Down. By Rat.
Lay It Down's pretty sexy. But Rock Me by Great White is that's a fucking song for sure.
It's a slow burn.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a big intro. Big intro. Great White's kind of guilt. There's some intros that's entirely too long.
But it works.
It works. It's like
Whitesnake. They're I don't want to say they're like a Dollar General version of Whitesnake, but they're a Dollar General version of Whitesnake because...
Yeah, I don't ever see... I don't know a Dollar General more so... I would say it's a more Trailer Park Whitesnake.
That's terrible.
Yeah, it's a little dirtier and unclean than Whitesnake.
That's... That's so judgmental.
it's like hey, did you shower? No. Okay, let's do it anyway. I think it'll be fine. It'll be fine because I don't think I can wait any longer.
What's neat about this is that people now see our faces saying these things. So you said that, and now there's video of you saying
Yeah, that's fantastic. And what'll happen, it'll get popped up out of context somewhere, and it'll just be me saying, oh, did you shower? That's okay. Let's do it anyway.
This is me now. This is what I am. This is who we are.
Yep.
Welcome to us.
Hi. We haven't showered.
All right, that's the end of the episode. There's I can't go anywhere from there. That's it.
Well, we fucked that one up.
Yeah. All right. Okay. All right. Well, Megadeth.
Yeah. So yeah. Your favorite album.
Yeah, it's Peace Sells. It's Peace Sells. I think Rest in Peace is arguably a more well-constructed album.
Yeah.
But the original mix of that album makes me hate. It just makes me hate. So I'll only listen to the remaster of it.
Yeah.
The mix is slightly different. So that's the only reason Rest in Peace isn't, you know, there. Because I think the original mix of Peace Sells is intact, even on the remasters.
Sure.
And I like Gar's drumming.
What's favorite song off that album?
Ooh. Probably The Conjuring. Probably because the intro is really, really dynamic.
Yeah.
And I did, but I really like Good Morning Black Friday, but the solo at the beginning of Good Morning is like, I want to be like, you guys, that's out of tune.
Yeah.
But then all of a sudden it becomes in tune and I go, okay, you're doing some weird Greg Ginn kind of shit. So
yeah.
Is it Rest in Peace for you?
Yeah, it's definitely Rest in Peace for me. And my favorite song off that album is probably Take No Prisoners, but I like Tornado of Souls as well.
Yeah, the ramp up in Tornado of Souls is,
yeah, it's pretty fucking great. But just Take No Prisoners is it's a little more thrashy. I just, that one makes me want to drive way fucking faster than I'm supposed to. That kind of song.
I don't like the call and response lyrics, and I just take no prisoners, take no shit. You know, like, I just
that particular lyric is the only thing that kind of turns me off about that song, is it's just, it's kind of like dumb and cliche, but I like that song. It's a great song. Great song.
Did you pay attention to Dawn Patrol?
No,
it's just the drum and bass, and Dave mysteriously with kind of an English accent, you know, just narrating that weird.
Where it
just makes me wonder, like, did Marty not show up that day? You know, wait, you couldn't put in a solo or something?
It probably just happened, and they were all like, that was pretty cool, just leave it.
does Dave like it? Were we rolling?
Yeah. And five magics on that song, or that album is good too.
Yeah, I think I think Five Magics is probably my favorite song on that album.
Yeah. I think everybody knew Hangar 18. Hangar 18 was super popular. That's the one that hit Headbangers Ball and they played constantly. But I don't like that song. It's
Do you like Holy Wars? The opening?
Yeah, it's okay, but I think that's a song I've heard so many times too that
just old.
It's just it's just kind of ran its course with me.
That opening riff though, man.
Yeah, it's super great.
Like Nick Menza kills it in that.
Yeah. Well, and then the rhythm to that that's great. That's
yeah.
Great. Any of those thrashy rhythms always kind of grab a hold of me.
Yeah. It's good. I still like I'm the solo on Sweating Bullets makes that entire album. Like that might be the greatest guitar solo I think Dave Mustaine has ever written.
It's fantastic.
Just that descending, that weird descending thing he does at the beginning of it. At least I think it's Dave. I don't think it's Marty. To me, it doesn't sound like a Marty solo.
Yeah.
No, but whatever. All right. Well, I'm not coming to Christmas, so.
That's okay. It'll probably be a fucking dumpster fire anyway. It's not. Christmas is fantastic.
Christmas is great. There's a lot of carbs on Christmas.
Lots of carbs and a lot of ham. Carbs.
And ham, right. Carbs and ham.
Carbs and ham. That's what we do at Christmas time.
All right, you guys. You know, make sure you take your Valtrex. So.
Jesus Christ. I was gonna say something cool and motivational, like, hey, you should give jiu-jitsu a try. You'll feel great.
No. Refill your Valtrex prescription. That's
don't fucking run out of your Valtrex. Fucking Christ.
All right. I'm not even doing the outro. I'm not doing it. All right. I'm done.
Hey, kids. This is your old buddy, the devil. I just wanted to call a timeout from burning all these souls into eternal damnation and let you guys know that if you don't want to go to hell, you should probably join the MTLB Ultra Mega Militia. You can do that by taking part in the MTLB Ultra Mega Value Exchange. You see, you get all of this free MTLB content, and then you get to decide what it's worth to you. And then you exchange that value with Music the Lifeblood. So if it's gonna be money, you wanna go the money route and be like, this fucking episode is worth $10. Sweet. All you gotta do is PayPal that over to musicthelifeblood@gmail.com, or you can do reoccurring installments at patreon.com/musicthelifeblood. You know, kinda like you were dating. It's a regular sort of thing. You don't want to be like all these guys. Because they're going to fucking burn in hell for the rest of eternity. And you guys don't want to burn in hell for eternity. But also, if you ain't got money right now, you can just share some Music to Lifeblood content on social media. That'll be fun. That'll keep you out of hell. And if you guys do take part in the MTLB Ultra Mega Value Exchange, you'll be a part of the MTLB Ultra Mega Militia. That'll probably get you into heaven. You can go hang out with my old buddy Jesus and his dad. They're pretty fun. They like to have a good time. They'll probably listen to Cannibal Corpse and Skeleton Witch. Have big old parties. Well, I'm down here with all these other guys that didn't take part in the MTLB Ultra Mega Value Exchange, poking them with pitchforks and burning their toes and throwing hot lava on their faces, I guess. Anyway, stay out of hell. Take part in the MTLB Ultra Mega Value Exchange so you can be part of the MTLB Ultra Mega Militia. Alright. Hopefully I won't be seeing you guys later.